Heartstopper's Kit Connor says he was forced to come out as bisexual. This article came after Kit Connor made the following tweet. I'm bi. Congrats for forcing an 18-year-old to out himself. I think some of you missed the point of the show. For returning viewers of this channel, I know it's been a while and I hope there are many of you returning. I have expressed my views on labelling and coming out and the complete lack of relevance that a stranger's sexuality has to you, but this article did get me thinking about why I think this way and also why people have just got this urge to want to know other people's sexualities and gender identities. I first came across this article scrolling through Facebook. Yes, I use Facebook. I'm old. Some empathetic people got to the article before I could see what loads of people are dubbed as the majority of comments, but there were still some. No one forced him. Guy needs to grow up a bit if he thinks that this was forced. Sounds like a publicity stunt to me. No one is forced to come out just because fans are curious. He shouldn't say he was forced. If he liked the ass, it's not our fault. But in this comment section, the majority were in support of Kit, or at least any of the criticism was buried amongst loads of positive comments. But how did Twitter feel? Because it was Twitter that Kit was originally attacking. Although yes, Kit got a lot of support for his tweet addressing his sexuality, he still got hated on for revealing it in the way that he did. And a lot of accounts rightfully pointed out that the support was only coming once he was revealed as an LGBT member, when in reality, that support should have been there when the harassment started. When I searched this on Twitter, it wasn't hard to find the criticism that Kit was facing, with accusations of queerbaiting, begging for sympathy, tweeting for attention, and being too soft for a celebrity. You know, because like being a celebrity means that you don't have feelings anymore and you know, you should be able to just take whatever is given to you. And in this case, the harassment of Kit results in fans being grouped together with these individuals. And because ignorance bleeds ignorance, we may run the risk of LGBT individuals being grouped in with this behaviour, as well as Gen Z snowflake generation that Facebook dads love to attack at any point. And so, these actions don't only hurt Kit, they hurt a lot of people, including those that these harassers share a characteristic with. This behaviour also affects the LGBT community in another way. It encourages bigotry, erasure, and transphobia from both outside and inside the community. When queerbaiting accusations are made about real-life people, it can result in the questioning of sexuality, it can threaten the validity of gender identity, and cause dysphoria and shame. However, one thing that seems to be a pattern in instances where celebrities are accused of queerbaiting is biphobia, and how pi and pan celebrities or public figures get accused of queerbaiting. This also affects gender non-conforming people or people that choose to remain unlabeled, because yes, this in itself is queer. Queer is an umbrella term coined by all of the LGBT community who have reclaimed the adjective, but it's also very popular in those that don't want to fit in a category. Within this discourse around gender binaries, there's often an encouragement to blur the boundaries that we have set up by defining the gender binary. This results in destabilization of the gender binary in many different ways. Yet when celebrities don't conform to gender norms, we accuse them of queerbaiting, or of using the LGBT community as a commodity, as pandering, as taking part in rainbow capitalism. The argument carries on and on. We argue that this destabilization of the binaries, blurring of the boundaries, the things that the discourse is encouraging us to do, is an act. The cis men are wearing makeup to pander or to sell more singles. The cis men that are wearing dresses are just trying to get more Twitch subs. All of this can be accused as queerbaiting, rather than people just expressing themselves, maybe, in the way that they want to. The ironic thing about this is that queerbaiting in its origin is a media term and isn't used to describe the behaviour of real people. Queerbaiting is actually a marketing technique for fiction and entertainment in which creators hint at, but then do not depict, same-sex romance or other LGBTQ+ representation. So it's mainly a thing that happens in fiction, and the idea is that real people cannot queerbait. Queerbaiting could be J.K. Rowling saying that Dumbledore is gay outright, but then only alluding to it in the books. Of course, we can now read into it and decipher that there is some evidence that he is gay, as well as the prequels that were written, but it wasn't obvious originally. It wasn't explicit, it wasn't a plot point, yet she decided to define him as gay after she released the books anyway. Of course, many would argue that doing this is a common thing, as it was still uncommon in British literature for characters to be openly gay at this point. However, JK's constant additions to canon make it believable that she only decided he was gay after finishing the books. Queerbaiting is benefiting from the LGBT community by promising queer representation and then not delivering it. You want a queerbaiter? Go criticize JK Rowling, someone who has done this in the past and also spreads harmful narratives about trans women. Criticize those that promised representation in Star Wars and then all we got was one measly kiss. And don't even get me started on how often queerbaiting happens in TV shows and anime. This is queerbaiting. This causes harm to the LGBT community and deprives them of representation. Not real people that might seem a little bit fruity but don't want to define the type of fucking fruit that they are. But this doesn't just happen to those who are genderqueer or don't conform to the conventional standards of gender. It is also common for bisexuality to be labelled as attention seeking, used to justify transphobia or be accused of transphobia, and in this instance be erased altogether due to the existence of opposite sex or different gender attraction / affection. This is the biphobic side of accusing someone of queerbaiting. Though Kit had never clarified his sexuality, it was assumed when he was seen holding hands with an actress, Maya Rafico, I'm sorry I've butchered that pronunciation, his co-star in an indie film, A Cuban Girl's Guide to Tea and Tomorrow. This is where the queerbaiting accusation started. Because we all know holding hands with a different gender makes you straight, so you are therefore queerbaiting for either approval, attention, or potentially stealing a role from an actual queer actor. Being bi just isn't enough for these people, I guess. The misconceptions that you have to have a 50-50 attraction split, the idea that you're not gay enough to be part of the community because, ew, gross, the straights are disgusting. Or you're greedy, or you're doing it for attention so that you can be different from mainstream people, aka a heterosexual or straight person. You're just confused and experimentation is normal and you'll go out of it, or are you sure you're actually gay but you're too ashamed to come out? Are you too fearful to lose your straight privileges? Because we all know that bi people don't experience any homophobia because they can just choose to date a gender different to them. Wow. Also, this is an exclusionary argument because you can consider yourself straight and then date a gender non-conforming person or a trans person and face bigotry for it, but yeah, that's an argument for another time. The fact that these accusations came out in response to a display of affection just highlights that biphobia is a real thing. And this is something that lingers both inside and outside the LGBT community, both in older generations and the younger generations. Now that we've explored the issues around debating the sexuality of an individual to the point that they feel obliged to come out or label themselves, as well as the issues with labeling real people as queerbaiters, let's have a look at why people may do it. You know, aside from complete nosiness and bigotry or lack of empathy towards a person simply because they are behind a screen or famous, sometimes accusations of queerbaiting can come from a place of protectiveness, usually over the LGBT community by members or by allies. It can be used to accuse actors, celebrities, internet personalities of faking a part of themselves that many people don't have the freedom to express for monetary value and attention. Of course, those that aren't real allies or detractors of the LGBT community will use these accusations to increase shame in LGBT people for existing openly in hopes of oppressing representation. This obviously comes from a deep-rooted bigotry and ignorance that many people sadly have. From a less hateful point of view, again, it can come from a place of protectiveness or defensiveness and fear of false representation, especially within the media. See, I have a background in drama and theatre arts, yes, a first-class degree from the University of Birmingham, and I'm still working basically a minimum wage job and living at home. Don't you just love the way that the world works? But something that I touched on when I was at university was casting methodologies. In particular, when I was looking at race and ethnicity studies, I learned a lot about colorblind casting. And from that, I've become increasingly more interested in the casting of non-cis and non-het characters, the arguments for and against casting actors that either do or do not match the sexuality or gender identity of the characters that they're playing, and other issues with representation in the media. An argument that is often noted when considering the casting of marginalised characters is that minorities and marginalised people are often discriminated against when going for roles. Even though many Facebook and Twitter keyboard warriors will have us believe that inclusivity is now at its peak and would go as far as saying that wokeness and political correctness is shoved in our faces on a daily basis, it is only recently that the media has begun to pay attention to marginalised people at all, which is probably why there's an outrage at the change of the race of the Little Mermaid, even though white actors have been playing non-white characters for decades. And so historically, they are already restricted from roles where race, ethnicity, and gender identity and sexuality aren't relevant to the story, so surely casting them in roles where race, ethnicity, gender identity, sexuality lining up is more essential, as not doing so is taking away even more roles and disallowing representation to come from the actual people who live the marginalised factors of these roles in real lives. That was a long sentence that I messed up multiple times. Why did I get a first? I do not know. I clearly don't understand basic grammar. Side note, when I say these factors aren't essential, I mean that they're not essential to the plot in order for it to make sense. Not that race, ethnicity, gender, etc. aren't important in their own right. For example, the race of the Little Mermaid isn't commented on in the story. Ariel was originally presented as white, and the story would make sense still. However, there are instances where race and ethnicity are part of the story, or at least adds to the context intended by the authors, yet they're still played by white actors. It's easier to focus on race and ethnicity when talking about this as an example, because there are more studies and discussion around it, even though it's still not enough or nowhere near the amount as there should be. However, there are examples of this happening in trans representation too. For example, the casting of Eddie Redmayne as a trans woman in The Danish Girl, or of Jared Leto as a trans woman in Dallas Buyers Club. Though there probably are other factors that come into these casting decisions, such as nepotism, the idea that a well-known actor will bring more publicity to a film that has a very important story, genuine concerns around gender dysphoria that could happen by making a trans woman act as a trans woman in the body of a man, and so on and so forth. But the argument still remains that this is yet another role that was not given to a trans actor, despite the character being trans. And this can be transferred to sexuality. If a straight actor gets a bi part over a bi actor, there is an argument over whether this is true representation. And even outside of this argument, it comes into question the realism of these characters. Are they actually relatable being played by a person that has no experience of that sexuality? How does a straight person act bi? Can you even act a sexuality? There is a risk of turning to stereotypes in representation to achieve believability, and sometimes these stereotypes are offensive. Yet all these arguments seem irrelevant now that Kit has revealed that he's bi, right? The fact of the matter is Kit shouldn't have to come out for the harassment to stop, even if the questioning comes from a place of self-preservation or genuine concern for representation. In counter to these concerns, a common argument is often made. Every so often there is a discourse around certain actors playing certain parts or disallowing white actors from voicing non-white characters, and a common rebuttal is simply pointing out that it's called acting for a reason. The whole point of acting is to act. People act like they're in love in the movies all the time, but they're actually not in love. So some may argue that it's the same with sexual attraction. You're not playing yourself. Of course, there are techniques in acting that draw on personal experiences, even though those techniques have been contested and considered far from the original practitioner's intentions. Bit of a nitty drama theory for you there. The emotional memory techniques, the magical if I was in this situation, how would I feel, etc., are often criticised for encouraging the acting of a emotion rather than producing an emotion from an action. Drama theory, blah 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 blah, what happened to gossiping about an LGBT show? But by this theory, Kit's sexuality shouldn't matter and shouldn't influence his chances of being casted in the role. And whilst I agree that protected characteristics like sexuality shouldn't negatively influence a person's chance of landing any acting role or job role for that matter, I understand that in some contexts this may produce false representation and result in the use of stereotypes to get into character. So, how do we conclude this? Well, for one, the use of queerbaiting is arguably incorrect. And two, even if queerbaiting was a thing and not a media term, that isn't what Kit was doing. So, the accusations were false. And regardless of where they came from, whether they were malicious in nature or came from fear or protectiveness over a marginalised community, the intention of an action doesn't override the impact of it. Regardless of the reasons as to why people acted the way that they did, they caused hurt and pain and either purposefully or unintentionally used biphobic talking points. Pressuring someone to come out when they're not ready shows a complete lack of empathy towards others, as well as an extreme ignorance towards the struggles that the LGBT community face or have faced. Both are things that should be worked out by the individual. And from another perspective, it's sad that the actions of a group of people may have a terrible effect on how people view other fans of Heartstopper. Thank you for watching this video. Hopefully there won't be such a big gap between this one and the next one, but I'm not promising anything because life is stressful. If you did enjoy this, please like and subscribe if you're new, and let me know what your thoughts are on this situation. And with that, hopefully, I'll see you soon.